Hello, distinguished speakers. I want to thank you all for the opportunity for coming to this session today, Cybersecurity in the New Normal World. This session is part of the 20th Convergence India 2021 Expo, and the organizers are the India Trade Promotion Organization and Exhibitions India Group. Our moderator for this session is Mr. Atul Gupta, partner KPMG in India. Over to you, Mr. Atul Gupta.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much, Jared, for getting us all together. It's a great session today. As Jared mentioned, we're talking about cybersecurity in the new normal world. And it's an unique privilege today for me to have two very distinguished speakers along with me. The first one, everyone knows him very well. No reference is required for introduction, but I will do that. It's Lieutenant General Dr. Rajesh Pant, who's the National Cybersecurity Coordinator, part of the Prime Minister's office. It will be great privilege, sir, today to get your perspectives on this topic. And along with Lieutenant General Pant, we've got Dr. Muktesh Chandur, who is the Special Commissioner, Delhi Police, an Indian Police Services Officer, who will be also sharing his perspectives around cybersecurity and the shift which has emerged upon in the cyber world at this point of time. Just before I get my distinguished speakers to share upon their perspectives, let me just set a brief context of how cyber risk has been emerging upon. And as Jared mentioned upon, I come in from KPMG. I lead cybersecurity for KPMG in India. We have seen that there has been a significant shift which has emerged upon on the way the cyber risk has been looked upon in the last 12 to 18 months. Cyber risk has always been considered as one of the top areas over the last 4 to 5 years because the nature of the risk has changed very significantly. Initially, it was looked upon more as a technology risk, but today, very clearly, the consequences of these risks are looked upon at a state level, at a country level, at a government entity levels, at critical infrastructure level, and as well as at enterprises level. The impact is felt not just across entities, but individuals in their personal life also get to feel this impact. The year gone by has played a very, very significant role. And that's the topic which we are discussing upon today, saying how cybersecurity in the new normal world is the most relevant area. And the reason why I say in 2020, the world has really awakened to the new normal has been because of all what we have gone through due to the pandemic scenario. But the good side of that pandemic scenario has been a rapid adoption of digital technology, the digital technology prowess which has come in to provide huge benefits to the society, to the countries, to the governments, and to the entities. While this entire adoption has helped us to move significantly in a positive direction, it has also opened up an opportunity for digital exposures to be increasingly higher or more becoming more a risk threat surfaces being increased upon. As KPMG, globally, we conduct upon CEO surveys. We conducted two surveys. The first survey which we had conducted was immediately post the pandemic settled in, which was last year, 2020. This was a CEO Outlook Pulse survey conducted upon. And globally, the CEOs recognized that cybersecurity is an area which will gain significant importance. Though at that point of time, when everyone was looking their ways to work upon with the pandemic situation, talent and supply chain was considered to be the top priority from a risk perspective, and then came cybersecurity. We further double-clicked on this similar Outlook survey, the Pulse survey, which was conducted in January, February, March of 2021. And this time, the global CEOs, they have very clearly come out, said that the topmost risk, which will have an impact on the business growth, is cyber risk. Very clearly showcases the way the entire dynamics has been shifting around when we look from a cybersecurity perspective. With that background, I think there are six key trends which have emerged in the year 2020, which further possibly both the distinguished speakers will be talking upon. But just I'll want to give a quick backdrop on the six trends which we are getting to see clearly. The first one, as I talked upon, is it's no longer the technology parts of the organizations which are driving cybersecurity, it's becoming responsibility for stakeholders, which are much beyond technology parts within organizations, within states, within entities, within countries, because the impact is very clearly felt. And truly, cyber has emerged across, if not always already established, but truly it has emerged across as a risk which needs to be prioritized, which needs to be addressed in a most effective and a timely manner. The second trend which has emerged is there's a huge technology adoption which has happened in the recent past, which has created an opportunity to bring upon a lot of new value, but also simultaneously there have been significant risk exposures which have emerged. There are multiple data points which emerge, and I did pick up on one of the data points which highlighted the number of incidents which, as a country, India, we have witnessed in the last year, calendar year. They've gone up quite significantly. And it's no longer just for the large enterprises where these incidents are going upon. It's increasing across the ecosystem where we are operating upon. The third big trend is working remotely. This was a big shift which has come across, which has caused the entire environment to change, and possibly the traditional security architecture principles which were followed upon, they have also gone through a significant shift at this point of time. Because in past, there was a very strong perimeter which was protecting normally the security mechanisms. Vis-a-vis now, the perimeter has possibly disappeared, and which is causing much more higher risk exposures emerging upon. The fourth trend is where cyber new terminologies have emerged. And I think one of the key terminology which has emerged is cyber resilience. Because the question is no longer saying, should we be protecting ourselves to protect against an attack? I think that philosophy is there, that mindset is there, that design principle is there, but there is a big shift which is happening, saying how do we make sure that we are resilient, that despite an incident happening, we continue upon the operations which are so critical to the requirements of the key objectives being addressed. The fifth trend is around the regulations, specifically on data protection. Regulations globally has been changing quite significantly. And as a country, we are also marching forward in a direction to have comprehensive data protection regulations. And the last but not the least trend is saying, how can we use this as an opportunity to create a trusted environment, what's now being called a digital trust environment. So I think these are the six key trends which we are getting to see at this point of time. But as I said, today is an opportunity where we have got great speakers with us. And on that back note, on that background, I would invite Lieutenant General Rajesh Pan to share his notes and share his perspectives on how he sees cybersecurity in the new normal world. Lieutenant General, over to you.
Thank you, Atul, and good morning to all the participants of this excellent event. Let me first thank the ITPO and the Exhibitions India Group for having me here and for organizing this 28th Convergence India Expo. You have chosen a very current subject of cybersecurity in the new normal world. But let me add a rider here that the new normal has actually not settled down as yet, because we are still in the midst of what in a cyber attack would be called the remediation process. So having identified the virus, we are now in the vaccine mode, and there is still some time to go. And once the entire situation has been brought under control and things settle down, I personally would call that as the new normal. Having said that, let me start with what our Prime Minister said on 15th of August last year from the ramparts of the Red Fort. And probably for the first time in the history of independent India, the word cybersecurity was uttered by the Prime Minister. And he described the importance of it in terms of its impact on society, on economy. And he also said as to how we are soon going to be tackling with the new cybersecurity strategy, about which I'll talk a little later. So it's been a very challenging year, I mean, for all of us, what the situation was 1 year back and how it was handled. But let me share with the viewers that the way our nation has handled it, I think is going to be an excellent case study. Starting from the clarity with which the Prime Minister announced the lockdown, the first, second, third, fourth, and then the unlock, the efficiency with which the 11 empowered groups were created under the National Disaster Management Act of 2005, the efficiency with which instructions were passed to the states, and the manner in which everyone responded, including the service of my friend Dr. Muktesh Chandra in khakis, and the public enterprises, and especially the private sector and the individuals. I think it's been a great response. Of course, we've had some major glitches like the migrant issue, etc. But on a larger aspect, when you compare it with how some of the other nations have addressed the issue, I think it's a thumbs up at a national level so far. So having said that, how does it impact cybersecurity? I think Atul has brought out those six trends excellently. Those are the ones that really matter. But let me go over some of them again and its impact on cybersecurity. And the first one that he said is that teleworking, remote working, or the work from home environment, which actually turned the entire architecture of cybersecurity upside down. Because so far, cybersecurity had a moat and castle approach, and there was one drawbridge through which the data entry was there. But then suddenly, with the work from home and the distributed environment, it became perimeter-less, or there's a lot of names for what is going on these days, software-defined perimeter, etc. So how was the enterprise expected to tackle that, I think, was the first challenge. And I must also say that the way some of the solutions came out in the time that they came out shows the brilliance of our entrepreneurs, that immediately aspects like identity and access management were tackled. These people knew what to do. Immediately, the zero trust architecture, people started buzzing about it, and how multi-factor authentication was to be used, and how were we to ensure that the endpoint, which was being used from the work from home or work from anywhere environment for that matter, how was that protected, whether to ensure that the apps that the person was using were the right apps, and was he using them for the amount of time that he's expected to use them. A whole list of issues was there, including the identification of the person. So in fact, just yesterday, someone was telling me that now they are also going into facial recognition, in addition to all the other aspects of multi-factor authentication. And every day we find a different presentation on identity, access management, and zero trust architecture. And it's really interesting how the industry responded to it. So I suppose that was the first impact. And as the saying goes, the cybersecurity principles changed from trust to trust no one and verify everything. I think that was the bottom line: trust no one and verify everything. So that was the first major change in the cybersecurity architecture. Atul mentioned that increase in cybercrime. So that went up significantly. The NSA on record has stated that it went up 500%. And within cybercrime, let me highlight the ransomware part, because that was most disturbing. And today you can go on the dark web and you'll find someone giving ransomware as a service. And these people are so smart that they have already done the research, the port scans, etc. They've already studied the companies which are targetable, if I may say so. They know the revenues of that company. And when they provide ransomware as a service, they tell you, you can get this much out of this. And of course, they have their own, share. And so ransomware as a service. And the manner in which the ransomware is being done is also getting more and more dangerous. And the targeting of that, these people are absolutely heartless people. So during COVID time, they targeted the research centers. And in India, you heard of Dr. Reddy's laboratories, etc. When there was Diwali and people wanted sweets, they targeted Haldiram's network. So they know who's the guy who's going to be under pressure and who will pay. And it's of course an international syndicate. And we also know why it is happening. at an international level, because today there is no collaboration at the international level. And the laws of, unfortunately, whether it is the MLAT or the letter of rogatory or even interacting with the Interpol, etc., somehow there is a big disconnect. So they're taking advantage of what is being called as the technical depolarization, etc. And, you know, these mafia groups and even state-backed actors, they are making a lot of money by ransomware. In fact, I attended the Singapore Cyber Week a few weeks back, where one of the members made a statement that last year, the loss due to cybercrime was $6 trillion. So that is, you know, twice the GDP of India. So that's the sort of loss and the importance of cybercrime. Then along with that has been the data theft. And again, you know, some of it was related to research. Data theft was always there, you know, but the scale, because of the COVID research, that it went up, and the manner and the targeting of that also, we found that, you know, during the last 1 year, it has gone up, and which we will have to be prepared for now. And as Atul said, I was actually hoping that in our budget session, the bill would get introduced, our PDP bill. But you know, you heard the same news that the session has closed 12 days early. So even the budget session is gone. Otherwise, I've been requesting, you know, this committee of Ms. Meenakshi Lekhi, and they're doing an excellent job by, you know, interacting with all the stakeholders, etc. So we now look forward to the next session where the bill will get introduced, because that's very important. Somehow we're not realizing the value of data. And I keep telling people, just look at what's happening around. You know, Microsoft, Facebook was fined $5 billion for that Cambridge Analytica leak, and they paid also, because their revenues are about 107 billion, so 5 billion is okay. So, and many other companies, you hear the GDPR, every day there is some company or the other being filed, and you know the fines in that. It's 4% of your global revenues or 20 million euros, etc. So somehow, I think the government is losing money. And of course, yes, there are issues as to what will be cross-border free-flow data, what stays inside, what is personal, what is sensitive. But we are not the first ones. It's by and large, it's the GDPR model that we've taken. So that's what I keep telling these people who have doubt as to, why didn't you raise a shindy when GDPR was being introduced? Why are you after the Indian PDP bill? But that's very important. Data security is very important. And that is an issue that will have to be tackled in the new normal. Excuse me. The next point I want to flag is the shift from IT to OT. You know, somehow we are under the impression that cybersecurity is all about protecting your data and IT assets, and the cyber attacks only deface websites and, you know, do other things. But the new, in the new normal, with the ICS, the industrial control systems, and the cyber physical systems, and the IoT coming in, and the IoT also is something like a cyber physical system. So it has a sensor, it has a processor, it has an actuator, and a communicator. And with 5G, already, as you know, there are 17 billion IoT devices. And after three years, there are going to be 30 billion IoT devices. And now you can imagine how wide the IoT, the attack surface will spread and what it can do. And already we are seeing the things happening. And you see what happened in the Florida, let's say, water treatment plant case, where also the same thing happened in Israel, where everything is automated. So in one case, they increased the percentage of chlorine, in the other case of sodium hydroxide, till it reached poisonous levels. And of course, many other cases have happened. The Israelis also retaliated against Iran, and what's happening with the power systems, etc., between USA, Russia, etc. So the impact on critical sectors, the impact on the OT systems is getting more and more difficult. So in the new normal, cybersecurity, a major part of it will have to go into protecting your critical infrastructure. And here there is an interesting issue where we had a seminar in Israel. Everything I'm saying is virtual. So, and the title of that seminar was, "Is Anything Not Critical?" Because with water, with food, with education, the new education policy, if you see in India, is all online education. And can you imagine a situation, you know, where JEE is going on, or some medical exam is going on, and everything is, you know, DDoS attack takes place and you can't give the exam, etc. Or even education for that matter is affected. So, is anything not critical at all? That is also part of the new normal. And finally, you know, there is this aspect of digital forensics. I don't know if Dr. Muktesh may speak about that. a lot of the cybercrime that we mentioned, 90% of the cases start with the mobile phone. And mobile phone forensics has suddenly become very important because on the other side, you have this privacy versus security issue where the companies are now creating these random keys inside the phone, like what Apple does. And the with every model, in fact, the security features are being increased. So for the LEAs now, it's become a very difficult job as to how to extract data, how to prove data. And as if that was not enough, the loop has not been completed. Because at the end of it, while the case is being investigated, when it goes for the prosecution, and the judge wants that chain of custody of the evidence, that is where a lot of loopholes are there. So it's very difficult to argue and convince the judge that, yes, this was the data at that point of time in this mobile phone or in this laptop, etc. So, these are some of the major issues that are going to be tackled or will have to be tackled in the new normal. So what are we doing about it? The last point that Atul mentioned was how can we create digital trusted environment? You are aware that the government of India on 16th of December last year has issued a directive which is called the National Security Directive on the telecom sector. So why telecom? Is because telecom is not only a critical, it is a super critical sector because it underpins all the other sectors where the information flow takes place is all over on top of the telecom networks. So the government decided to tackle the telecom sector first. And even in that sector, there's a complete environment starting from the endpoint, the network, the data centers are there, etc. So we decided that let's tackle first the network part because that is where already some license conditions are there with the telecom service providers. So the directive has come out and that lays out that from 15th of June this year, all the equipment that is going to be connected on the Indian network is going to be a trusted product. And what is a trusted product? What is a trusted source? Is what we are going working on at the moment. My office is working on that. And trusted source is basically the company which manufactures the product. And within that product, we will be seeing some of the active components, basically the chips, and seeing whether it qualifies to be a trusted product or not. So that exercise is going on. The portal is under development. The entire exercise is going to be through a portal that the TSP will upload the product that he wants. We'll do our background checks quickly and we will ensure that ease of business is not adversely affected. So that part is being handled by the National Security Directive. It's probably the first time in the world any country has done it because all the others came out with a negative list. They said that company X and Y are in the entities list and will not work here, etc. The government of India said we don't want to have a negative list, we'll have a positive list. We'll say that, okay, if you have these qualities, if it's in the national interest of India, then you are allowed to enter. So that's a significant change and it's very exciting. You know, we get feelers from all over the world as to how we are going to manage it. But let's see, come June 15th, then you'll see how it happens. The second and the final major point is our new strategy, which is going to tackle a lot of these issues. The entire ecosystem is being tackled. And the basis of that new strategy is that cybersecurity is a whole of a nation approach. And there is this concept of CBDT, common but differentiated responsibility, where the individual has a certain responsibility, the organization has a certain responsibility, and the business and the government and the academia have their own responsibilities. So, and of course, the vision is now out as to how we will ensure a safe, secure, trusted, resilient, and vibrant cyberspace for India's prosperity. And there are a number of deliverables in that. So that would be an exciting thing to look out for in the future as to how we will tackle cybersecurity in the new normal. I think I've covered the ecosystem to whatever best I can in the limited time. But once again, let me compliment both the ITPO as well as Exhibitions India for organizing this 28th Convergence India Expo. I wish the event all success. Thank you. Jai Hind.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Lieutenant General Spahn. I think some very great insights that you have shared upon. And you raised us as we went through how cybersecurity has to be looked upon in the new normal. And you also highlighted when the new normal is going to come. We should not be in the myth, the new normal is already there. Maybe it's the 0.5 state which we are. We still need to get to the final state of new normal. But the areas which you highlighted, very relevant. I think one of the areas which you brought upon and it stuck with me, and I'm sure it stuck with all the audience, is saying anything is not critical or anything is not connected at this moment. Let's bring in criticality subsequently, but it's more about connected. I think today everything is getting connected onto internet, and you just gave some very brilliant examples on how, as a country, as a government, we are also moving forward in a direction where things which we would have never assumed in past or anticipated also in past to be getting online are now today completely digital, completely online. And that's bringing in a big element in the new normal, saying what needs to be looked upon from a criticality perspective. Very, very great point. And thank you so much. I'll come back to you, Lieutenant General Pant, because, you know, I'll currently go down to have perspectives from Dr. Mukesh Chandra as well. But as we close out the session today, you know, I would like you to highlight some of the obligations and some of the responsibilities which each one of us who are attending this session today and who will be watching the recordings also subsequently should be following upon. There may be a lot of learnings which have emerged, and I know you highlighted upon new cybersecurity strategy and a policy to emerge upon. While it comes across very exciting to see, but what can we do in the meanwhile just to make sure that we are in a more resilient environment? So I'll come back to you on that one. Thank you so much. On that note, let me move to Dr. Mukesh Chandra. Thank you so much, sir, for being available today. And as was highlighted upon, cyber incidents have been increasing rapidly. And, you know, we have seen a significant spike in the year gone by, and the incidents continue to increase upon as we speak. And that's bringing in two, three very different perspectives. One is, I think Lieutenant General Pant also talked upon on forensics, and I would like to get your perspectives around the same. But I think more importantly, you know, as the theme of the event also talks upon building a digital and a smart India, there's a whole lot of smart initiatives being taken across the country. And one of those which is very fundamental to the country is smart cities. And as more and more initiatives, digital initiatives get rolled out as part of smart cities, it helps us to bring in huge opportunities for citizens, for the government, but it also possibly exposes us to various sets of risk. And it will be good to get your perspectives around those. So let me invite you, Dr. Mukesh Chandra, to share your perspectives around this topic. Thank you, sir.
First of all, good morning, General Pant. Good to hear you and the latest happening in the Government of India from the cybersecurity perspective. We all have been always eager to know what's going on under your leadership. So my compliments to you. Thank you, Atul, for inviting me to this 28th Convergence India Expo. From what General Pant left, a few of the things I want to highlight. One is that we all know that number of cyber crimes are increasing, and the official statistics from National Crime Reports Bureau of 2018 to 2019 show a 63% increase. But the total number of cyber crimes reported in India in 2019 was about 44,000. At the same time, a large number of incidents were also handled by certain. From the police perspective, I feel that this figure is not the true picture of what's going on in cyber crimes. As it is true for other crimes also, there are a number of reasons that crimes do not get reported or registered or etc. This figure, in my view, should be very high, going by the number of certain incidents, because every incident, security breach incident, has to figure into somewhere into a criminal activity, and then a case should be registered. The we already are aware of various big time cyber crimes like Cosmos Bank of Pune and State Bank of Mauritius in Mumbai. Now, these cases are exact replica of what went on a few years back in US and other places. I'm reminded of that $45 million heist of New York. The Cosmos Bank case was exactly a copy of that, and we knew that it is coming, but still these cases did happen, and we hardly learned any lessons out of it. Now WannaCry, world over, it made an impact, and it touched Indian systems also. Again, how many cases were registered as in these, and how many cases were investigated and culprits caught? This is just for anybody to guess. Now, from the citizen's perspective, the cyber crimes, petty cyber crimes, where some few thousand rupees are lost by various means, this is not that kind of alarming. What is alarming is cyber espionage. Now, this is a topic which I have been covering in my stint in NTRO, and also attack on critical information infrastructure of the country. Now, NCIPC is functional, and I contributed a lot into the functioning of the NCIPC as well as the guidelines. But still, those guidelines are only guidelines. The version 2 is also a guidelines. The mandatory kind of cybersecurity framework still is eluding us, and I'm sure the GDPR kind of data protection law, which is likely to come up in the next session probably and become a law, so that the mandatory compliance regime is implemented in India also, just like GDPR. And serious thought is given because of the serious penalties. Now, you know, taking example of a helmet, when the helmet, you don't wear helmet while driving or riding a two-wheeler, the earlier the fine was 100 rupees. This fine was fixed in 1988. And over a period of time, it was realized that the compliance has gone down. And therefore, in the last amendment to Motor Vehicle Act, the fine was raised to 500 rupees. In the same way, unless there is a not merely wearing a mask today carries a fine of 2000 rupees. So if you want certain compliance, then certain mandatory requirements have to be there, and non-compliance results into some consequences. You talked about smart cities. This is one important topic, and I've been talking about it also. 100 smart cities are coming up. Everything will be sort of connected. General Pant also mentioned about IoT and OT. But the problem is that in the beginning, the cyber security was not a component of cyber smart city setup. It was only after various police organizations intervened, and then the security and safety components were also introduced. Otherwise, in the thought process in the beginning, police and cyber security sort of thing was almost missing in the smart city conceptualization. Again, from the government perspective and from the implementation perspectives, the smart city security requirements have to be built into all the components from the design stage itself. But I'm still sorry to say that IoT, which is going to be a big component of smart city, we still do not have IoT related security guidelines. The bare minimum IoT guidelines have not been introduced. I am reminded of UK in 2018, they were talking of 12 minimum cyber security requirements for IoT, and out of that, 3 they have recently made compulsory, mandatory. So any IoT device which is manufactured or introduced in UK, these 3 mandatory guidelines have to be followed. And very soon the remaining 9 will also be made. But in India, still we do not have any such minimum mandatory requirement. Now coming back to the National Cybersecurity Policy of 2013, we have come a long way from that. And I have been writing a lot about need for cybersecurity strategy, which is already coming up. General Pant has already mentioned that very soon we are going to see that. But my worry about that also is that the financial component involved in the strategy. I just want to give an example of the first national cybersecurity strategy of UK for 5 years. It had a budget of about 900 million pounds. The second cybersecurity strategy, when they came up, it had a budget of 1.9 billion pounds. And there were tangible, measurable outputs defined. Every year there was an evaluation of what was being done, and it was a comprehensive strategy, and that resulted in them coming to number one rank in the global cybersecurity index from 10th position. Whereas this is also a fact that we were 23rd in the rank, and we later on slipped to 47th rank in 2018. The recent global cybersecurity index figures have not come up. They are likely to come up in the next quarter. So that will be an indicator where we have gone in terms of comprehensive cybersecurity thing. But the strategy which is coming up, it's a well thought of strategy. I have I did make a presentation in this regard also. What are my thoughts after coming from Chevening, where this was my topic of research. I would also like to mention that smart cities will bring smart criminals, but at the same time, we probably do not have that kind of smart citizens, or maybe if I can use the word stupid citizens, who are not even concerned about cyber by road safety. So what to talk of cyber safety? So a large number of awareness of the common man who is involved into this will be required, including the students, young generation. You did mention about cyber forensics. Now, this is an area where some cities, some states have done very well. Delhi, Pune, Bombay, Bangalore, and Cyberabad. These are the places where I can say that infrastructure funds and the knowledge exists, but at many other places it is still not up to the required standards. Indian Cyber Crime Coordination Center has already come up, where there is a portal where people can report on cyber crime from all over the country, as well as the National Cyber Forensic Laboratory has now come up with online tools also. So any police officer from any part of the country can just connect to the server and do the forensics of all kinds online itself, and the results will be available. Now, the cyber forensics has also diversified into so many different branches. The multimedia forensics, the social media forensics, and the WhatsApp particularly. Now, WhatsApp has also brought the challenges of end-to-end encryption. And in my talks with the various agencies which are providing solutions of cyber forensics, still we cannot crack DBcrypt 12 files. In fact, yesterday I was evaluating the cyber forensic products which were inducted into Delhi Police. And I did ask this question, without the phone, without the key, can you decrypt a DBcrypt file, 12 file of WhatsApp? So this is still not there. So in terms of decrypting our capabilities of our country, I think we have to go a long way in terms of stack analysis, malware forensics, IoT. IoT is one where IoT forensics will be required. I don't see anybody talking of IoT or embedded system forensics in police, at least. Everything is going on cloud, so we'll need cloud forensics also. But at the same time, I would say that we are not what we were a few years back. The cybercrime challenges are forcing police to acquire new knowledge, new tools, new technologies. But the indigenous products in terms of cyber forensic tools are still very few. CDAC Trivandrum has been developing some tools which are available. Initially they were available for free, later on they started charging for that, but what I see is that most of these forensics tools, whether we are talking of Oxygen Forensics or FTK or NCASE or whatever, they are all foreign made forensic tools, and there is a need that we develop our own cyber forensic tools at the earliest. This is also a requirement in terms of DIIPP guidelines of Atmanirbhar Bharat. I think that is what I have to say in the beginning in terms of cyber security environment and what I see as a police officer. Thank you, Atul.
Thank you so much, Dr. Muktichander. I think some very great points which you highlighted, very beneficial for the audience, and you brought out very clear perspectives on IoT. You talked on smart city quite extensively. You brought in very deep perspectives around forensics as well. And one element which you talked upon on how UK has been able to transform their position globally by bringing in huge focus around cybersecurity strategy and funding around it. I think that brings across a very pertinent question, and maybe I'll just put it across to both of you, and maybe General Pant, you know, you could also share your perspectives while you have already shared the broader viewpoints around this. I think globally we get to see and we tend to look upon some of the practices which have worked out very well globally. There have been two approaches which have been taken. One is either a state-oriented approach, which is more country-oriented approach, which is where Europe really focuses upon typically. And we talked on GDPR as one of those regulations which has made an impact. And the second approach typically is, as we were referring to, critical infrastructure, which is more industry-focused and regulatory-oriented, but not going or stopping only on guidelines, but mandating. I think today's environment possibly requires a combination of both. It's a hybrid need which is existing. You need to have baselines which are there at a country level, and you need to have more sharper focus by the industries where the exposures will be much higher. But just wanted to get your inputs, perspectives, General Pant, on that one, the point which was raised upon.
Yeah, Atul, you're excuse me, very right that at the end of it is finances that matter. In fact, in the 2013 policy, it is an excellent policy. But unfortunately, it did not have an action plan and a financial backing. So we had conceived a project, NCCC, National Cyber Coordination Center, which was to come up in a certain length of time. We are still in phase one of that. That's a very important project, you know, for threat prediction. We had planned to scale 500,000 people in the cyber skilling in 5 years. That 5 years ended in 2018. I think we've not even reached 100,000, you know, of a certain standard. And so that is a lesson learned from last time. And just to update you, in this time's strategy, we have an action plan where the deliverable has been given, the responsibility has been given, and an approximate funding has been proposed. So that is part of the strategy, which is under discussion, as I said, in the Cabinet Secretariat at the moment as we speak. So as far as the industry goes, you know, we have always been saying that at least spend 10% of your IT budget on cybersecurity. And what I find is that while some of the, you know, some banks are spending more than 10%, you know, some of the industry that feels impacted by it is really taking it seriously. But by and large, you know, especially the SME and the MSME sector have still not caught up. But now, in the so-called new normal that we are discussing, I find that a lot of products are coming out which meet the SME as MSME requirement as a managed services also. So there is a change I am seeing. But you are very right. You said hybrid approach. I call it the PPP model. And the solution has to be a PPP model for the cybersecurity at a national level. And the reason for that is that in the critical sector, for example, the telecom, out of the four major TSPs we've got, three are private players. So only BSNL which is the 100% government owned, but Airtel, Reliance and Jio are all private players, and similarly in the power sector, etc. So the solution will have to be a mix of that, where the government comes in is to lay down a cybersecurity governance at a national level, an architecture at a governance at a national level, and this is what we are working on. For example, let's say a threat exchange. Now, why should everyone pay to all these companies around the world and buy the threat intelligence for their own selves? Why can't it be procured centrally from so many different other countries at a lesser cost and then distributed through a threat exchange? Similarly, the malware repository. Today, if there is any malware found, we report it to VirusTotal, which is headquartered in Singapore, and it is a Google company. So we are now building our own national malware repository, where you can report a virus and that will tell you, you know, the history and everything else about that virus. So these are some of the actions that, you know, architecturally are being done at the national level. There are some other things, if you want, I can speak about it now, but the specific question that you asked was about the PPP part, etc. So that is how it's being tackled.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Lieutenant General Rajesh Pant, for sharing those perspectives. I think very, very valuable, because yes, as a country, I think we are moving in the direction where the government will be bringing the overall governance. And thereafter, it's an approach which needs to be adopted by the industry and all the different elements which are coming on the digital platform. Digital cities or smart cities are just one of those examples. There will be many more which will be emerging. I think one other area which I wanted to bring across and will be very relevant for the audience which is listening to this and attending to this session today, and again, perspectives from both of you would be very welcome. In the year gone by, we have started hearing a new kind of an attack which is being termed as a supply chain attack. And I know, General Pant, you talked upon on positive list as a country where we are moving and telecom is where we have started. But it's bringing across a significant element of risk across the entire technology platforms, and not just enterprise IT, it's also on the OT and IoT specifically, saying how do we get an assurance that what is embedded, what is part of already running software or even embedded devices is adequately protected, adequately secured. I know it's a very, very broad question which I'm asking at this point of time, but what will be very beneficial for the audiences is if you can share your perspectives and some of the learnings which people can take away and can start trying to follow upon, that will be immensely valuable. And it's again coming in the current new normal, because some of these things have emerged at this point of time. In past, we would have never encountered similar situations. So good to get your perspectives.
So let me start, if Dr. Muktesh doesn't mind. So, so far we were thinking that supply chain...
Please, sir, please.
So far we were generally under the impression that supply chain attacks are broadly hardware-based supply chain attacks. But the recent SolarWinds case has woken up everyone up to the fact that there is a software supply chain which comes through your updates and the different versions, etc. And I would request all those who are keen on the subject of cybersecurity to please study how well this has been executed, as to how they first entered one particular company, and through that they came the Orion update and came to those 18,000 customers of that network monitoring software. And then through that, they went to the cloud of those customers. And then, it's an amazing case. And whoever has done it has employed a large number of people, because we found the infrastructure was changing in this attack. You know, normally one infrastructure is used. So please study that. It's a software supply chain attack. Now, having said that, coming to your point of embedded systems, as part of this recent exercise we are doing on trusted products, etc., in the last couple of months, let me tell you how chips are manufactured. I have got the opportunity to study the entire chain as to how the sand comes, how it is purified, how silica is obtained, how the boron and phosphorus doping is done, how the PNP transistors are made, how in what file format it is designed, how the fabless semiconductors are made, how the foundry works in the fab, and how the ATMP process, you know, the marking, processing, packaging works, and how it is distributed. That is the most important. And recently, McKinsey has done a study recently for Intel, Dell, etc. The tier one suppliers are 5,000 to 6,000, and for tier one and two, 15,000 to 20,000 suppliers are there. So that is the enormity of the problem, right? So coming back to what we have done in order to obviate this and to make it, you know, practically implementable, is that we are only going after the active programmable components. Because in any product in a box, you know, there is a PCB, there are wires, there are fans, there are, you know, passive components. So all that is being taken out, because that really, in the first priority, does not affect cybersecurity. What matters is your active programmable content, and you mentioned about embedded software. So that is what we are getting, and we have seen that the master bill of material, master BOM of these people caters for it, and we have asked them, and they have said, yes, we will be able to give you as to which all chips are there. So once we have the details of these chips, then again, we are going back to our concept of trusted sources and seeing where they are coming from and where they are being manufactured, because the same company has manufacturing in X country and Y country, etc. So that is a plan we have, and we intend implementing it. Although you know, some people say it is very difficult, but that's you know, we have always taken on challenges head on, and this is how we're going to tackle this aspect of supply chain. Thank you
so much for that input, Dr. Mukhtechandar. If you have any perspectives on this topic, that will be great for the audiences.
That's a very interesting background Dr. General Pant has mentioned, but being an engineer, I would like to mention that when we were studying engineering, electronics and communication engineering way back in 79 and 80s, Semiconductor Corporation of India was the one which was manufacturing a few chips. And I used their FM radio chips and so many other chips in the beginning, and we were keen that very soon semiconductors will be made in India and chips will be made in India. But unfortunately, we missed the semiconductor bus, and we were good in designing chips but not in manufacturing chips. Incidentally, Pentium chip designed by Vinod Dham, he is an alumnus of my college only, and but the chip went to Pentium, and it was manufactured in USA. So in the same way, now can we catch that bus now, or is it too late? As everybody knows, and General Pant has also elaborated how silicon chips are made from silica, and then it looks so easy, but it is very, very complex, and making a foundry, establishing a foundry is a very complex as well as costly affair. We still don't have. We are always talking about various how to catch that bus right now. I'm not sure it can be done. It cannot be done. Maybe General Pant can say that. The second is evaluating of those chip, evaluation of the hardware embedded systems. Now, we were talking few years back, we were talking of EL labs in India. The evaluation of these hardware up to a certain level is possible, but beyond that, we need designs, we need codes and so many things which no company is willing to share. So the reliance on evaluation is also not a guarantee that the chips are not having any embedded malware at the hardware level, but we do have examples of many such examples where some certain hardware manufactured in a particular country is behaving mischievously. So the supply chain, from where it is manufactured, from where it is sourced, is important. At the same time, various countries are also talking of banning certain products from certain places. Huawei is one such example where a lot of debate went on, even in UK, whether to buy 5G products and infrastructure from Huawei or not. At one point of time, they did ban it, US has already banned, but later on there were talks that no, after careful consideration, 5G infrastructure would be bought from Huawei or Chinese companies in UK. So this is something which is so complex. The assurance level of any embedded devices, whether it is IoT, OT, or chips, has to be seen in the larger context from the country's perspective. And the best bet would be to get our own foundries in India.
Thank you, Dr. Mukteshchandra, for sharing those perspectives. I think this is an area which is constantly evolving, and obviously newer and newer thoughts are emerging. As General Pant mentioned, supply chain attacks were always associated with hardware till December 2020 came in, when the realization globally happened, saying it's not just hardware, it's software. And in today's world, when OT, IoT, control systems, connected devices, and edge computing is becoming a reality, and with 5G already becoming, talked upon to soon become a reality, I think some of these questions are becoming even more important to be addressed upon. And I am absolutely aligned with what both of you have talked, saying there's a way for us to move forward on this journey. And that's the intriguing part of cyber. It's never a endpoint. It's never a destination. It's a journey on which everyone has to keep on walking upon and moving forward. And I think, General Pant, you said it's a PPP model, which has to work, which has to constantly evolve. I'm cautious of time. We've got into the last 5 minutes of the scheduled time, which is available with us. And I want to go back. And as I said, right up ahead, it will be great for the audiences if both of you could share 3 to 4 or at most 5 tips that they should be following in their day-to-day practices, whether they represent today large enterprises, whether they represent critical infrastructure enterprises, or they are a common residents or citizens of the country. What should they be doing? It will be a great takeaway beyond all what we have discussed so far for the audience to really pick up from the session, and specifically factoring in the new normal element or area in which we are living upon at this moment. So with that, let me go back to General Pant. If you can share your perspectives, and then followed by Dr. Mukteshchandra.
No, there is no two ways about it now. If you have to survive in the new normal, the first priority is hygiene. And hygiene has two components. One is your personal hygiene, and second is cyber hygiene. Personal hygiene, if you want to remain alive and healthy. Cyber hygiene, if you want to be safe in the digital world. And you all know what cyber hygiene involves. Your passwords, your antivirus, your software, how to give permission to various apps, and to not click on unnecessary things or wishing or phishing. So that is the first one, advice for the individuals, that please adopt cyber hygiene policies and protect yourselves. For the organizations, I would recommend that you please separate the IT and the cyber parts of your enterprise. Because wherever I go, mostly I find that it is the IT guy who's handling the cyber also. It's like judge and jury. Whereas now cybersecurity has become so complex that you require a separate team under a CISO. And that CISO has to be well qualified. And this not only goes for the private sector, it goes for the government sector as well. And all the departments in the government as well as the states, somehow I'm really not satisfied with the capabilities and the qualities of the CISO. So a lot of work needs to be done there. Then we have to understand this concept of a security operations center or a SOC, which continuously monitors your enterprise as well as carries out the incident response. And finally, at the government level, as I said, we have to ensure the cybersecurity education and awareness at a national level. Certain architectural aspects I've already mentioned. We have to provide resilience by giving the concept of assured defense posture. And we have to ensure the cyber skilling standards and testing that we spoke of. I think those are the major issues. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Very pertinent. Thank you, Lieutenant General Pant, for highlighting. With that, I'll move to Dr. Mukteshchandra. Sir, your tips for the audiences.
Yeah. From the organization point of view, the first important thing is to acknowledge that there is a problem. The first step towards solving a problem is to acknowledge that there is a problem. So the organizations must understand that, yes, there is a challenge. The second is the top management must be convinced about it, that yes, there is a problem and we have to find a solution for that. So then comes the role of security organization, including the CISO, which General Pant spoke about it, laying certain budget for that, maybe 10% as General Pant was mentioning. Then reliance on certain tools and technologies. But at the same time, the man behind the machine is very important. The cyber hygiene is important. Educational education, awareness and training of the people who are handling these systems. Because any tool and technology will not work if cyber hygiene, basic cyber hygiene is not observed. And then organization-wide culture of cybersecurity. Now, this culture of cybersecurity sort of thing is missing. We do have a road safety week. We have so many days. But still in India, we have not perhaps earmarked a day for national cyber safety. All over the world, the several days are observed as cyber safety day or cyber safety week. And a massive campaign, like in Corona times, we did have under the guidance of our Prime Minister, massive campaigning about hygiene, Do Gaj Ki Doori and mask and all that. But in the same way, we don't find that, I don't find a single poster in any IT organization where they say that certain cyber safety tips have been displayed. So this culture of cyber safety in an entire organization where everybody is talking about it, and in the beginning, I missed that, every organization has to have a cyber security policy. What is to be protected, how it is to be protected, what systems have to be in place. Are we going for ISO 27001 certification or we are going for any other PCC DSI compliance or Data Security Council of India compliance. So certain kind of norms have to be followed. And based on that, a comprehensive cyber safety action plan has to be prepared for an organization. The usual thing I have seen is that when there is a crisis, it's a preventive, not preventive maintenance, but breakdown maintenance kind of approach which is followed. So as attacks takes place, then they run here and there, and many a time they don't even report to the breach to the police and try to bury it down. This kind of approach, ostrich approach, I would say, doesn't work. We have to understand that yes, there is a threat, yes, there is a breach, now it will cost money and we have to spend. Wishful thinking that attack won't take place in their organization doesn't work.
Sure.
Yes, sir.
Thank you so much for making those very pertinent points. I think all of these are very, very relevant, what General Pant mentioned and what you have mentioned, sir. But I think what stuck to me is about the culture. How do we make it as a habit rather than it just becoming a layer over the top? And maybe what you highlighted, saying we tend to react rather than being proactive in addressing it right by the design. On that note, I just wanted to highlight one thing, because you said cultural aspect and it resonated very well with me. I'm sure it resonates very well with others. Globally, the month of October is celebrated as a cyber security month. Maybe that's a point which we can take away from here, saying how can we as a country leverage on this global program which is run across various states, various countries, and have multiple calendars going across in the month of October, which is also normally a very festive period in the country. So it gets coincided with that area. And I don't want to really talk upon on what we as KPMG are doing, but this is just very close to me. I just wanted to highlight, we have been organizing something called Cyber Day in the month of October, where we go to schools and impart education and awareness to the school children, because we believe they are the future of the country. And if we can impart them right at that point of time, that's going to be very helpful in their building phases itself. So great points. Thank you so much, Dr. Mukesh Chandra, for highlighting those.
Thank you
so much, Lieutenant General Pant. I think insights which you have shared have been very, very deep, very insightful. It will get reflected across by every audience which has joined in today. And we'll look forward to the comprehensive approach which the government is taking, both from a data protection as well as from a cybersecurity strategy. Thank you, sir, so much. Have a good day, sir.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciated by you, Atul, and all the best to all the participants. Thank you. Bye bye.
Thank you. Bye bye.
Thank you, sir.
Have a nice day, sir.
Good day, sir. Good day.